Most people look at Thomas Edison and Berry Gordy, and the natural thought is, what could two people like that have in common? Totally different fields, totally different time in history, totally different everything. One's in black and white, one's in color, one's standing alone, the other guy's got all these stars around him, you know, from Stevie Wonder to, who else is there? Yeah, Smokey's there, and is that Diana there? Probably, yeah, it's Diana Ross there. So anyway, those are the, so very different people, very different walks of life, very different businesses, total different time in history, and yet those two men have something phenomenal in common. Something phenomenal. Both of them used a development factory to achieve their fame and create great wealth. Now, what do I mean by a development factory? Well, develop a replicable formula for production of a desired result, identify people with demonstrated potential, wrap around them all the resources required for success, and then replicate, 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 replicate. How does this work? Well, let's start with Thomas Edison. Now, everybody knows Thomas Edison invented the light bulb, right? Right. Thomas Edison probably touched a light bulb before it was finally developed maybe 10 times in his life. Thomas Edison didn't really sit there and tinker with any of the things that he's given credit for. The brilliance of Thomas Edison was he created an invention factory. And all those thousands of experiments on the thousands of different filaments before the final right one was determined for the light bulb, Thomas Edison didn't sit there and do those thousands of experiments. He had scientists that he hired in his factory that did that. And while they were working on that, somebody else was working on phonograph. And somebody else was working the phonograph, okay? And the other one, the movie projector. I mean, basically, other people were working on all this stuff. He supervised it. He orchestrated it. He gathered together all the resources that made it work. He decided in the end which ones they were going to work on and which ones they weren't. He was the one who developed the manufacturing formula by which all this whole operation got put together. But he didn't sit there and invent the light bulb. In his invention factory, what he did is he developed a replicable formula for production of new inventions. And here's what he did, simply. He identifies a need. He conceptualized the solution. He built, the next step was to build and test a prototype. The next step was identify what works and doesn't. The next step is conceptualize a solution for what doesn't work, and then build and test another prototype. And then you keep rotating around that circle over and over and over again. Keep the process going as long as it takes to produce the viable solution. Okay, that's the formula. Okay, so every product that he came out with, that's the process that it went through. And then what else did he do? He identified people with demonstrated potential, scientists, engineers, toolmakers, craftsmen, brought them all in under one roof, and wrapped around them all of the resources required for success, from the facility, to the equipment, to the material, to the supplies, to the support personnel, to the capital, to the manufacturing capability, to the marketing. And it was a factory. And after the invention was turned out, it went to the next department of the factory, which is, how do you produce the thing and market it? And it all went through the same formula. Replicate, replicate, replicate. What about Berry Gordy? What did his factory look like? Motown, Hitsville. That was his music factory. His replicable formula was to take unknown people who look good and can sing, and back them up with great songwriters, musicians, music promoters, etc., produce hits that turn unknown singers into stars. Berry Gordy said when he went very shortly after he started Motown, is that he's going to take his people from within 3 miles of where he had his Hitsville studio. That's all he cared about. Diana Ross lived within that 3-mile limit. She worked at the studio as an administrative and a secretarial person. She demonstrated her ability to sing, and so what did they do? They backed her up with the best songwriters, the Funk Brothers, the backup band that played for every one of those early stars, had the same backup band. Holland Dozier Holland, same writers, okay? And there was a sound to Motown that when you heard that sound, it didn't matter who was singing it, you knew it was a Motown song. Okay? Because it all came out of the same factory. Identify people with demonstrated potential, singers, musicians, songwriters, recording engineers, image designers, graphic artists, music publishers and promoters, etc. Wrap around all of these people the resources required for success, Hitsville, recording studio, recording equipment, capital, manufacturing, marketing. Okay, and you grind them out, replicating them one after the other after the other. Now, why am I telling you all this? I have a reason. What do Jay Abraham and Gordon Bazar have in common with Thomas Edison and Berry Gordy? You got it. Very smart lady. I know somebody's actually been listening here. Okay, we refer to it as the wealth factory. And here's our formula. Develop a replicable formula for the production of the desired result. Take entrepreneurs with demonstrated potential, wrap around them all the knowledge and resources required for phenomenal success in their field, and facilitate their transition into creators of great wealth. That's our factory. That's our basic premise. And to that, we then have to identify people with demonstrated potential, including entrepreneurs, business executives, inventors, marketing pros, visionaries, finance wizards, organizational and structural experts, motivators. List goes on. It's a lot longer than that. And then wrap around these folks all the resources required for success, including the knowledge, the capital, a communication center, contacts and access to relationships, established mentors, etc. Everything it takes to overcome any obstacle an entrepreneur faces. Now, our expectation, by the way, is we're not going to do it for anybody, but we're going to empower them to do it for themselves. Because that's the whole basis of an entrepreneur. You can't have an entrepreneur where we got to go be the entrepreneur, right? I mean, you got to have, okay. And then the idea here is to replicate, replicate, replicate. Jay and Gordon's wealth factory. Now, this is kind of interesting because when you talk about wealth to most people, this is what immediately comes to mind. You know, the houses, the cars, the limos, the yachts, the jets, and all that stuff. See, I look at that and it's kind of like been there, done that. And the one thing you start to realize after a while that all that stuff, it is just stuff. It comes, it goes, it rots, it rusts. It requires maintenance. It has headaches. You know, there are benefits too. And you know those. I don't have to tell you those. But at the end of the day, those are made in the toy factory. What I'm talking about here is the creation and generation of real wealth, wealth and power. And with wealth and power, those are the toys you play with, but that's just it. They're just toys. I know you can't see all the detail in here, so I won't even try to get into it, but a whole lot of stuff going on in this wealth factory. But where it all begins is taking individuals who are entrepreneurial and have demonstrated potential. In other words, we are not looking for people to bring through our process, people who are just starting out. In fact, if I had come to me as my 26-year-old, I'm not sure I would take me, because at least not until after I'd bought the first business. Because we're looking for people who really do have demonstrated success, people who where we can look at their track record and say, okay, this is a person who exhibits those features that say we can work with them to take them to whatever their next level is. And then the objective is after we support them with what it is that they need in the form of the knowledge, the experience, the mentoring, the capital, the everything that they need, is to bring them through a process where out the door come people who are substantially into businesses of major size. We refer to it as business wealth your way because neither Jay or I are here to tell anyone ever you should be in the XYZ business or you should do it this way. We're working with entrepreneurs, and the important thing is to do it your way. You have a vision, you're that person who has the vision, and you accept that obligation to orchestrate the resources of other people to make your vision real. Well, this is your way. This is about who you are. This is about you coming from your core of who you are to build something that in the end is you. And that's why we refer to it as your way, because if you don't have that inner drive, that inner passion for what it is that you're doing, you're never going to be the biggest kid on the block. You can't be, because the biggest kid on the block is going to be somebody who has that passion, who it is them, who when they go to work every day, they're fulfilling their destiny, they're fulfilling who they are. And so I ask you, what are your goals? What are your goals in your business? Okay, and I shouldn't say your business, in your field of endeavor, because your business, we all know what that is now, don't we? Leveraging yourself through other people, that's your business. Using their resources to build your dream, that's your business. And whether it's a $10 to $50 million a year fierce competitor that you want to end up with, a $100 million a year sales Goliath, a $1 billion a year market dominator, or a multi-billion dollar corporate empire, that's the output of this factory. That's what we're here to help produce. Doesn't matter whether it's in service, retail, wholesale, or manufacturing, the objective is to take Jay's expertise in the marketing and business success area, my expertise in the acquisition and finance area, and the capital that we have access to, the relationships that we have access to, and to wrap those around people who have demonstrated potential. Now, when we go back to this business here for a second, the factory, there are lots of ways that we have of wrapping our resources around you. Think about this. I'm going to now take you to another level of business development. Does everybody know what it means to go public with a company? Okay, it means, you know, all of a sudden you're on the exchange, right? Or you're at least listed on some pink sheet someplace. The idea is your stock certificates are then sold to the public, you collect the cash from the sale, your company now has equity, and you have people trading your shares in a public marketplace, determining the price of your shares based on how much that public thinks about your future. Okay? It's the ultimate way to come out of a business if you're successful, because now, instead of owning stock certificates that are paper that you can put on your wall, you own stock certificates in your company with a public market price on it, which means someday you're going to convert that into real hard cash by selling those stocks, those share certificates, into that public marketplace. So you have something new that you didn't have before, which is called liquidity. It means that now you don't have a hard to sell privately owned business. You've got a public company that there's a market price for on your stock and people are trading it every day. It's a whole new level of business that gives you access to things that you don't have as a private company. So what do you think one of the early goals are for our factory, for our wealth factory? What do you think we're going to do with it? We're going to take it public. Okay, and why are we going to do that? Because that's exactly the platform that we want to have to help launch these businesses. Think about this. First of all, there's a problem today going public. Now, in 1972, I love going back there because those were the good old days. If you wanted to go public and you had some profits and you had a little history behind your business, you could go to an investment banker if you were at least a certain size, okay? You know, you're making them, you're selling 10 to 20 to 30 million a year in sales, you're making $1 million a year in profits. There's a certain point where you got to a point where you could take your company public. You go to investment bankers on Wall Street, any of them liked you and thought you had potential, they would take a position in your company, they would advise you, they would take you under their wing, they would help you sell the stock to the public, they would earn some nice fees for this, they would get a little piece of your company for helping you out. It was a wonderful enterprise, a wonderful way that you could get public in those good old days. The good old days are gone forever. If you had that same business today, there ain't no way you can find an investment banker who would even look at you. All the firms that did that kind of thing are all gone. They don't exist anymore. And so there's this big hole now of how do companies that are emerging, getting to a certain point, they either go to the vulture capitalists, right? You know, give away a big piece of their company for some of the cash they need, okay? But they're still not public. In fact, they have this big stockholder called the venture capitalist that they got to go deal with. So the question is, how does a company that's in this position today get public? Well, there is a way. It took us a long time before we finally ferreted it out and developed the right relationships to make it happen, but here's how we do it today. How many people here are familiar with something called a hedge fund? Okay, you've heard of them? Okay. They can make investments that normal mutual funds can't. And some of these guys are really savvy, man. These guys know how to make money, and it's why some of these hedge funds make tons of money. We sat down with a couple of them, and we worked out a program with them for how we're going to get companies public. And here's how it's going to happen. We're going to be taking the wealth factory, and it's only one of many that will do this way. We will get an investment from a hedge fund. Not a lot, a couple of million dollars. And for that, we'll give them a nice piece of the company, you know, 10%, 15%, some nice number. But believe it or not, these guys are really smart. When they give us that $5 million or $4 million or $3 million or whatever the number is, they know they can't lose. And why do they know they can't lose? Because here's what they do. They have relationships. Who do you think their relationships are with? Other mutual funds, the regular kind. So here's what we're going to do. They're going to invest the money in the company. They're going to get their stock position. Immediately, with that money invested in the company, we do what's called a reverse merger. Out there are public companies that have failed and are just shells. All they are is a shell. They're a corporation with stock in the hands of public owners, a lot of stock in the hands of the old principals. The company has no transactions, nothing's going on, and the stock is worthless. Now, if you're the owner of one of those companies, and there's nothing you can do with your stock, it's worthless, wouldn't it be kind of neat if somebody came along and said, look, we're going to sell you our company that's going somewhere, and your company's going to buy our company, and all you're going to give us is stock in your company, but you're going to give us so much stock in your company that we're going to end up owning your company. And you're going to own this little piece of it, but this little piece that you're going to own is going to be worth so much more than the nothing it's worth right now. Because we're going somewhere, and here's where we're going. So you do this reverse merger. They acquire us, but we now own them because of all the stock they've issued to us. Okay, and because a hedge fund owns a big piece of our company, how much of that stock do they get? They get their percentage, don't they? Because, remember, they own 15% of us. So if we end up in now owning 95% of this other company, then they own 15, in other words, their 15% is equivalent to now, say, 14.5% or something like that of the final company. Okay? So now they own stock in a public company, right? Because we did this reverse merger with a public company that had nothing in it before. Now, why do they care about that? The hedge fund cares about it a lot, because the minute it's a public company, what do you think they now do with their 14.5% of the stock of this company? What do you think they do with it? They take half their position, and they will sell it to their mutual fund buddies. First thing we do is there's a step here. They're called market makers. Market makers are now educated as to what our plans are, and they get excited, and they go out and start finding buyers to start trading the stock at higher and higher prices. The hedge fund sells half their position to the mutual fund, to their mutual fund buddies. And why is this important? That is, they're mutual fund buddies. These guys all know each other. They all eat at the same clubs. They all, go on vacations together. They all talk to each other constantly. They're all buddies. Okay. So what do? They apportion the stock out to their mutual fund buddies, and now there's institutional ownership to this public company. The institutional ownership has a vested interest in seeing the stock price at a certain price because it's now part of their net worth, right? Okay, so they're only trading the stock between each other. So what do you think they traded at? The agreed upon price, the price that they're all comfortable with. Now, eventually, this company has to do something to justify all this. But in the beginning, it doesn't have to do anything to justify this. Just have a good potential. The next step is the hedge fund now has no risk in this transaction. Whatever happens, they're ahead. The mutual fund's got some risk, but they're betting on the hedge fund's wisdom in picking us to do this with, that this company's really going to do something. And so that's their play in this. Okay, now, how does this company, this factory that went public this way, make money? Well, there's all kinds of fee income that it's going to have. There's all kinds of income that's going to produce. But in addition to that, we're going to take these people, these companies that we're now bringing through here and wrapping all of these resources around them. Who do you think is going to be the investor in these companies?
Us.
And when we put our money in, what are we going to get a piece of? The company, because that's what the game is. That's how it's played. So we're going to have little pieces of ownership now in all these companies that we're helping market, that we're helping, we're wrapping all these resources around that they could never have any other way and helping to make them successful. So is this kind of win-win? Yeah, it's really, really win-win. Okay, now let's follow it one more step. Some of these companies, we may find we acquire them outright. Some of these companies, we're going to own very big pieces of. But let's say we own 40% of one of these nice companies that are coming through here, and it's really on track now after a lot of help in the marketing and a lot of help in a lot of ways. It's really on track to make some big money. And now that company is right to be a public company on its own. How do you think we get it public? One of two ways. We either take it through a reverse merger like we did, or when you're a public company, you can spin off stock that you own in other companies to your shareholders, and the spin-off of that stock to your shareholders makes the company a public company. Because all the stockholders are, guess what? They're people in the public. So without going through an offering, without going through an underwriting, we can make any company that we have as a part ownership in, we can literally make them a public company. And we can go through the same thing with the hedge fund investment and the anyway, what I'm trying to do here is give you a picture of how we can start to bring resources to these companies that most entrepreneurs don't even have an idea that these things exist, but they do. Our objective in this process is to turn your business into a wealth-generating machine, to optimize to help you optimize your goals for your business. And again, we don't care where you want to go with it. You know, you pick the place, you pick the market. That's all yours. Our job is to make sure that you're supported, that you have everything you need to get the job done. And whatever you don't have, we feel, you know, we're there to help fill that bill. One of the reasons that we're putting this factory together, if you will, and I refer to it affectionately as a factory because I think, to me, factory is a good word. It means something gets produced there. I mean, that's what it means. Is we can afford to take and bear certain burdens that you alone cannot afford to bear, because we're not going to be doing them just for ourselves. We're going to be doing it for ourselves and a whole bunch of other folks that are coming through this process. So part of the resources that we wrap around you are the resources to deal with a lot of the things that would be crushing if you went to deal with them on your own. And the Sarbanes-Oxley, I didn't get into it, but it's one of the areas where we can afford the specialists. We can afford the automated systems. We can afford that because it isn't just one company that's having to pay it. It's literally a burden that can be distributed over many, and then the burden gets light. Any other questions? Yes.
You talked about asset-based leverage buyout. What kind of instruments are out there for companies which are like intellectual property-based, like software or other kinds of companies, which don't have any hard asset that you can lend against?
Okay, so that's a good question, that you don't have any assets that you can leverage against. Okay, well, there in that case, you know, one option is still a lot of seller financing. The seller is still going to be issuing a, you know, you're still be issuing a note to a seller for a substantial portion of it. But when it comes to intellectual property, there are two, and I know Jay's here, so I don't want to keep him just waiting here too long.
Right.
Okay, but there are two companies that I'm currently working with right now on two major significant acquisitions. In one of them, intellectual property was a big issue, okay? And I can give you a little brief description of how we finessed this problem. One of the things that we did is we developed, well, let me tell you a little bit about the company, okay? So otherwise this won't make a lot of sense to you.